everyone, welcome back to Dragalia Lost. Today we are here for a very big pre-analysis and showcase of the new adventures coming tomorrow, which I won't be rolling on tomorrow, but maybe I will on the 5th, whenever the free rolls run out. Because we have so many new adventures and dragons in one banner that maybe it is worthwhile to try my luck in at least trying to get one of them. Both of the adventures look very fun and both of the dragons look very good. The Gala Dragon actually looks the least interesting between the Zodiac and the Galawan, but that's not to say that she's bad, she's actually quite good. It is just that the Beast Aghido Niche is indeed a niche by itself, and indeed I kinda spoiled who it is the Beast Siella. So, my guess here is that they are trying to divide the adventurers and the dragons of the Aghidos, and we will probably have the dragons as the ones who died, and the adventurers, of course, as the one that survived. That's my correct guess, we will see if it is true. Let's not waste any more time because we have a lot to go through. Hopefully I will be able to wrap it up very quickly so that we don't go overboard with the analysis, even though that should be the best way to do it. So, this gush will run on for 6 days, after that the two Zodiac characters and the Zodiac Dragon will progress into the Prize Showcase, probably with all the Zodiacs, so do not worry if you miss out on them. However, in general, this banner is better because it has better rates and in general also a better luck for me, but for you maybe it doesn't, who knows. Remember that we have 50 free pulls to go with this banner, so wait before going all in and use the free pulls as much as you can. But let's start, we have the very first dragon, which is Gala Beast Siella, of course water, and of course, much like Gala Beast Volk, she comes with very huge benefits and very huge, let's say, penalties. So let's start with the dragon skill. This time we have no amp, however we have good damage, frostbite and deals damage to surrounding enemies. Not too bad, kinda simple, and in some cases better than Volk, which had to charge it up, etc. So it was kinda difficult to use, but in this case it is kinda simple. At the cost, however, of no strength up, which can be sort of a downside in many ways. Then we have their usual passive of strength plus 100%, and also, regardless of their attunement, grants the user a dragon strike while shapeshifted as a Beast Siella. This deals damage to the target and summons a crystal arrow. Up to 2 crystal arrows can exist, but they will disappear automatically over time. Beast Siella standard attacks will bounce off these arrows, and hitting a crystal arrows with a dragon skill will cause it to deal damage to surrounding enemies and disappear. So the crystal arrows, if you remember the Siella boss fight, are those arrows that she stuck into the ground, and whenever she did the twisting beam attack, those arrows shoot out icicles from them, so I'm guessing that will work all the same. It means probably that her dragon damage is very high, which is what I'm guessing here, to the cost of having probably a lower utility outside of dragon form, so kinda the opposite of Volk. Volk was very good outside of dragon form because of his passives, the extra punisher, etc. In dragon form he was still very good, but very limited in what he could do, because he wanted to power up the Blood Moon. In this case it is kinda the opposite, but even not really. Then we have the other passive, or aura if you want. If the user is attuned to water, extra damage to frostbitten enemies, so the punisher continues, and you have a debuff which you can stack by using standard attacks in the dragon form when the combo count is 15 or higher, called vulnerability. This is also from her boss fight. Vulnerability can stack up to 10 times, each stack reduces defense by 1% and frostbite resistance by 2%. This can be removed by the enemy, if it doesn't, it stays for the whole fight. So being removed by the enemy means that they can cleanse it, much like any other kind of buff, the debuff rather, that you can inflict, such as Mikersom Zero or let's say Gotsu Tenno debuffs against damage taken from wind and fire sources, to name some. Affliction, stuff like that. So it's not too tragic, but it is very huge if you think about it, because minus 10% defense throughout all the fight and frostbite resistance can be pretty good. And then we come at the penalty. Regardless of the attunement, reduce the user defense by 20% and shortens the window of the combo time by 1 second. So if you think about it, this penalty can be very easily fixed by putting Gala Elisan in the backline of your water team, because she gives both defense and combo time as Erco Abilis. Kinda thematic and also very easy to fix compared to Walk, which was very risky indeed. So I will say this. The question is, should you pull? So her niche is very obvious. She will go better on units that benefit a lot from dragon damage, frostbite, and that can exploit the defense. To name one that I use a lot, Forager Cleo has punishers against the defense down, so for her it is a permanent increase in damage. Other than that, she is pretty much a very very good water dragon, standardly so. Probably not as good as Galareborn Poseidon overall, but still very very good. The penalty this time is quite simple to overcome, so I don't think that there is any sort of problem in which adventurer you want to choose to go with her. Should you pull? Absolutely yes. She is going to be good regardless, so even if you don't have the perfect adventurer for her, she's still a very good dragon. Then we move from dragon to dragon to Fudomio. This is the wind zodiac dragon of this time, and she is the tiger. So Fudomio is actually very interesting because she works off a double buff. One is more defensive and it is called Mantra of Compassion, which gives a double shield made up of your maximum HP, which will nullify damage if you take it while under this shield. The other one is Mantra of Wrath, which will give you damage, basically. So let's read what she does. The dragon skill deals damage to the target nearby enemies and grants the Mantra of Compassion effect. Pretty decent damage, inflicts a Storm Lash, and also gives you this 2 charge shield, which is very helpful. Strength plus 70%, and then the aura. At the start of quest, if the user is wind, you get 2 uses of the Mantra of Compassion. Basically, it is always 2 uses. I kinda was wrong in saying 2 uses. You get 1 buff, which is 2 shields. That's what I want to say. Whenever this buff runs out, because you expire the shield, you get Mantra of Wrath. And whenever you expire those shield and you have Fudomio, you also get 50% of your Dragon Gauche, which is pretty helpful because it means that you can go back to Fudomio, use again the dragon skill to get another shield and continue this sort of effect. But you also get Mantra of Wrath. After activating the Dragon Gauche Filler, it will not activate for 180 seconds, Mantra of Wrath increases attack rate by 10% and does 30% to the modifier applied to damage against water attuned enemies. Pretty substantial buff, in my opinion. Attack rate is one of the best buffs in the game, and the modifier against water attuned enemies is pretty much the Reborn effect. In this case, with some extra buff, so she is pretty much a better Gala Reborn Zephyr in many ways. My main question here is if Mantra of Wrath is a permanent effect. I'm guessing that it is, and that it doesn't disappear whenever you reapply Mantra of Compassion, but that is something that I cannot tell at the time. But for now, regardless of that, I would 100% tell you to roll for Fudomio because she has a very crazy utility in both auto and manual play, and also with the new Zodiac Adventurer which she collaborates with, which is Shingen. My friends, do not miss out on very good dragons. Even if the adventurers that I'm about to show you are very interesting, this dragon can probably be a key part for the future of boss fights, especially against the upcoming Zero Mercury. Let me tell you that, because Gotsu Tenno was a key part of why Gala Leonidas was so good. She can replicate the same with whatever new wind adventurer might come past her. So yes, do aim to get at least one copy of Fudomio. And now we have the 2 new adventurers. One is Shingen, the other is Yugimura. Shingen is wind and an axe, much like his dragon, and Shingen has a new effect, which is the... Let me take out the name so that I don't confuse it. Burst Gambit. Burst Gambit, you can check out this new buff into the help section, is pretty much a buff that you inflict onto the enemy with a counter. This counter will go down every time you inflict an affliction on the enemy with something, be it an attack, shared skill, skill, etc. You need to inflict it. You can't drop down the counter by inflicting it and the enemy resist it. You need to inflict the affliction yourself, and also it cannot be lowered by the enemy refreshing or dispelling the buff. It can't be lowered by someone else if you are doing a raid, etc. it needs to be you and your characters, I suppose, because it tells you specifically that for raid it doesn't work, but it never goes down deep on whatever other characters in your team can work. What does the burst gambit do? Well, it is a different effect on every character. In the case of Shingen, it heals. In the case of Yugimura, it does a ton of damage. Both of those characters are equipped to use plenty of affliction, so you will see that the counter probably will go down very quickly. But now let's read what Shingen does, because there is a lot to go through. The first skill is Furin Kazan. This is a very powerful attack that he has to prepare, and it has different phases depending on how many stacks of veteran metals you have. 3 stacks is the best, but you can use it even without any stack or with less than 3. Of course, the best way would be to use it and then not tap, because then you will consume the stacks of veteran metal that you have, so that you can wait until you have 3 stacks and then get the very huge benefits. So let's read what it does. With 0 stack, you deal damage, apply the Burst Gambit Tiger Burst, which heals, and inflict Stormlash. If you continue to tap and you have stacks with you, it will deal extra damage with those taps equal to the number of veteran metal stacks that you have. If you use 3 stacks, you get another buff, which is called Battle Fervor, which pretty much powers him up to a lot. All his skills get their maximum effects, and he also gets another passive, which gives him extra strength and damage that we'll see in a second. When you use this skill, he will be immune to knockback, and also when he uses it, which is a pretty good effect because it means that you will never be interrupted with this skill. If you are using Battle Fervor while using this skill, the screen can be tapped up to 3 additional hits without having to consume Veteran Battle. However, you won't get Battle Fervor again, so it won't be refreshed, which is kinda sad because it means that you have to repeat this every time to get his best possible result. The damage, as you can see, is pretty nice. The effects that you get: 1 hit, you lower strength. 2 hits, you inflict Scorchrend. 3 hits, you get the Battle Fervor, which is pretty nice. The skill energy required is pretty low. It is his only damaging skill. However, he has a pretty substantial buff thanks to the Battle Fervor that he gets. His second skill grants a defense amp and 1 veteran metal. Pretty huge skill energy required, but from what I understand with this character, he has a pretty unique standard attack and skill gauge fill rate, so it shouldn't be that much of a problem. If this skill is used when you have Battle Fervor, you get Defense Amp, Max HP Plus, and you reduce damage taken. So far, seems to be a pretty simple kit. You work off the stack to get a powered up S1, and the Max version gives you sort of a 30 seconds crazy mode where you get all the best effects as much as you can. Co-abilities are the standard ones, and then we have the unique passive, which is Tiger's Tenacity. Grants the user 2 stacks of the veteran metal when they take damage, so here is the second way to get this buff, by taking damage, so he's a literal tank. And you can see why Fuyo Mio works so good with him, because she denies damage taken by using the shield, and so he takes damage, he doesn't take damage, but he still gets the stacks. Veteran Metal can stack up to 3 times, and after this granted, this ability will not grant it again for 20 seconds. So the idea here is that you get damage, you get 2 stacks, and then you use the S2 to gain the third one. Pretty simple reasoning over here. Also, you have a unique 4 strike. While charging the 4 strike, damage taken will be reduced. Damage from some attacks cannot be reduced. After charging, if the user takes damage while executing this 4 strike, that damage will be reduced. And the user will be granted 3 stacks of veteran metal, so a third way to charge it up is a 4 strike charge up, which is probably the best way and the fastest one as well. The user will be immune to knockback and while charging the 4 strike as well as when executing it. In addition, if you have Battle Fervor, the 3rd and 5th attacks in the standard attack combo will create Cyclones that pursue the target, similar to Liu to make an example. So let's kinda repeat what you need to do with this character. You want to use him to get him to its best version, which is with the Battle Fervor. To do it, you need to charge up your 4th strike up to the maximum and get 3 stacks. Take damage and use the S2 to gain 3 stacks, or just find a cross between those two. Then you use the S1 with all the charges, you consume them and you gain battle fervor, and from then it is maximum damage mode because as you can see he gets this other skill. When the user has battle fervor, increases the damage dealt by their attacks by 50% and increases the strength by 20%, so he gets a pretty substantial buff with this other buff that he has. Overall, not so complicated as it might seem, even though there is a ton of text. Pretty good, because he has a lot of stuff going for him. Defense up, a lot of tankiness, a lot of damage and affliction, and overall, a lot of versatility, there we go, I would say it. Now the question would be, should you roll for him? Yes, but you want to be prepared for a complex playstyle with this hero. Also, you kinda want to have his dragon with him, which is Fudomio, because otherwise he probably might not work at its best. He's probably the worst of the four in this banner, if I had to say, because he's kinda, I won't say complicated, but very technical as a hero. You really need to work around this niche to make it work at its best. But for sure, he's very good. Unlike Seimei and Yoshitsune from last year, I can see this hero being very, let's say, a key component in some autocoms and even in manual as much as possible because of how he works with his skill set. The fact that he can raise his own HP, defense amp, all the affliction, the damage, and also overall what he can do while he's using his skill and for strike by reducing damage can be quite essential as well. So it's a yes. And now we have Yukimura, which is probably my favorite part of this banner and probably why I will chase after her whenever we get to the fifth. Yukimura is a Dragon Ball character, said in simple words. She has a true fighting mode, which you can see behind her, which seems that she drops the spear and starts using punches. Where she grows her hair, as you can see over here, it turns white, and then also her eyes change color, pretty much a SSJ version of herself. If you guys catch the equivalence over here. Much like Shingen, she also has a unique Burst Gambit, but this one deals damage instead of healing. To reduce the Burst Gambit once again, you want to inflict afflictions with your character. 15 is the counter for Yukimura, 30 for Shingen, so while they might seem a lot, they get down pretty easily. Understand me when I say that, because you do spam skills a lot. Now Yukimura is a lot more simple than Shingen to understand. To activate her true mode, which is permanent through the fight, you want to use RS1 3 times, so in some ways it is pretty much like a sigil. Skill shift 1 deals damage, skill shift 2 deals damage, increasingly. Skill shift phase 3 deals damage and you activate the fighting spirit, which is her powered up mode. You will be immune to knockback during this attack, and if the S1 is used whenever she is powered up with her fighting spirit, she uses a variant called Monkey Tiger Brat. This variant will go onwards if you keep tapping the screen, and also you will apply Monkey Burst again whenever you use the skill, and applying the burst again will lower its countdown by 1, so it is a pretty good way to lower it, and partially fill its gauche again. So basically you can spam the S1 with Yukimura whenever you are with Fighting Spirit. Of course you will have to replenish it a little bit because it won't fill it altogether, it is only a partial fill, but it is still pretty good. When Monkey Burst is activated, it will deal damage to the affected target and nearby enemies. So, look at the value of the Monkey Burst, which is why probably I think that she's so good. 15 afflictions that you need to inflict to deal 43,000 damage. That's really a lot. And the skill by itself also does pretty good damage. With such a low skill energy required, think about how quick you can lower the Monkey Burst to deal this damage. It is pretty good indeed. The second skill is Monkey Cross Drive, this deals damage to the target and nearby enemies and partially fills the skill gauche for Monkey Overdrive, which is the first one over here. So as you can see, you can spam her skills pretty easily. S1 powered up fills it by itself, S2 also fills it, so it gets as a pretty spammy skill character. If you are under the Fighting Spirit, this will become also another tap-tap skill, with Shadow Blight, and then if you tap to the maximum you also inflict Scorch End, which help with the Monkey Gambit. The damage here is also pretty good, nodding to crazy but still pretty good with a pretty low skill energy reward. So, here you can see that Yukimura is a very skill damage heavy character, with not so much going on about her, she's pretty easy and simple to use, but with a ton of damage behind her. And also some utility, because she still has the affliction stuff, even though it is a cross element, not really her own. You have Shadow Blight, and then you have Scorch End, which is for fire. Combo time, 6, which is actually pretty good. And then we have all the buffs that she gets whenever she activates Fighting Spirit. Strength plus 10%, skill damage plus 40%, immunity to knockback, new standard attack patterns and upgraded to skills, which you already saw, and a dodge that is pretty much like Gala Zetia, not Xena, because you can interrupt it and deal damage while you are dodging, and then if you attack again you restart the combo from where you left it, which is crazy good. And then we have Flurry Strength plus 20%, which is a standard buff, pretty good. It is still a pretty worthwhile buff. I hope that they made it unique so it worked through Nahiriti, but I guess if it was the case, she would be too good. Should you pull for Yukimura? Absolutely yes. This character is both fun from the looks of it, because she basically becomes an SSJ character after you use this one 3 times, and then you start tapping the screen as if you are punching the enemy yourself with Yukimura, and then you also have a ton of utility with how she works in terms of damage, because she basically becomes a Gala Xena but with affliction. That's the main comparison that I would put over here. So if I had to rank the 4 characters from this banner, since there are so many, I would say Fudomio, then Yukimura, then Gala Beast Siella, and then Shingen. That would be my priority over here. If you have Zetia, probably you will go with the 2 dragons, then Shingen and then Yukimura, because Yukimura kinda fits the same role as Gala Zetia, but with Shadow Blight. That is how I would put it. But she's very very fun from the looks of it. Anyway, my friends, this was the pre-showcase, pre-analysis of this New Year's Gala Dragalia. Pretty exciting, I cannot wait for tomorrow to see their stories, to get the new characters, hopefully with the free pulls and more. Hopefully you are looking forward to it as well. Of course, I will try to get the stories out first and then the gacha later, because I want to use the free pulls. But if I get a new character, who knows, maybe I will be able to put up a Kaleido showcase or a Nagito showcase, or even, sorry, not Nagito, a Dominion showcase, or in this case, no, we don't have any new Dragon Trials, so for the Dragon Trials, still needs some time to get to Jupiter and for Mercury, but in the future, maybe we will use Shingen for Mercury if we get him. Anyway, for today, this is it. Let me know in the comments if you like those new characters and what you think. Hopefully, I was clear enough, and hopefully, you enjoyed your time. Remember to like and sub to support the channel, and remember to tune in tomorrow for the new stories and more under this New Year's Eve and then New Year's Day. Thank you very much for watching. This has been Hunter Lodge with another pre-analysis. Hopefully you had fun, and hopefully I will see you next time. Bye my friends, and have an happy New Year's from yours truly. I will also post something with art for the New Year's, do not worry, to thank you guys and everything. Bye my friends, enjoy your time.